Hello? Is this going? Is it on? Okay. Okay. Testing. Yeah. I can't hear myself. Is it?
The PA monitor is really low.
It's on low?
The volume of it's really low.
Let's go.
Okay. Yeah. I can hear the feedback and the ambient noise, but your voice is not really being amplified very much.
So I might as well just talk. Can I just talk like this?
Sure. It's your panel.
Yeah. Okay.
So he's polite to a fault, man. I love it.
So if you guys want to just go ahead and play, we're going to play a quick video just so you get an introduction of who we are. Can we turn the lights down for that video? Is there a place to turn down the lights?
Hey!
Oh!
I'm scared!
He needs to make 900,000 to get his next Archer. No! There it goes! The championship is over at 892,304 points, and our winner is Ben Gold. Bobby?
Eric, thank you very much for a terrific game. Sorry it didn't turn out better. And Ben, you're the world champion no-feed shooter.
Well, you could say Pac-Man fever is driving a Denton man crazy.
Scott Patterson loves playing old arcade games. In fact, he holds nearly 300 world records.
I was never satisfied with just beating the game. I wanted to just smash the game. I wanted to beat it into the ground.
We are down to just over a minute through in PSP's round, and right now he has 103,000 points. He's getting ready for a humongous multiplier, folks. 33. The game speed is at 35, 36. Mind you, for some of
he's
you who do
it
don't
it.
Know.
He is crushing it.
Oh, here I am. I feel like you're a celebrity.
These micro machines, there's Ben. He's having a ball. The world champ of Nintendo. And the way I say it, if the world champion that has played every Nintendo game that is out on the market is over here cutting up, having a ball, this is what he plays.
70,000 Rich Ambler concentrating. Here it comes, Tetris! Setting it down along the way, pulling Thor Aackerlund now. He opens up the channel. 10, 9, 8. Last seconds of play. Who's going to take it away today? 98,000 Rich Ambler could do it inside. Toss off a double. Look at Thor go. Right to the end.
Well, this is 1991, it's a big one.
Well, that was a little highlight reel, or what? Oh,
it's looping.
Let me go ahead and.
This is a recap, just in case you weren't. everybody here, I'm sure, esports are, you know, kind of a growing phenomenon these days. And I hear it all the time. A lot of people, you know, whether it be social media coming up at events, and they're talking about things like MLG, they're talking about all those competitions are going on right now. And I don't think a lot of them realize that we didn't call it esports back when it first started, we just called it playing video games. I don't think a lot of people realize just how long it goes back. I mean, starting with some of the things that Twin Galaxies did, starting in the early 80s, all the way through the crash in the mid-80s, but even back again, going into the 1990 Nintendo World Championship, and a lot of, some of the competitions and stuff started coming out of that. So, from my seat, the modern-day esports and all these competitive leagues and everything that are coming up have, there's a lot of things that they can learn, they can take from those earliest days. Because while the games might seem worlds different, really a lot of the lessons are going to hold true. They already have. I think they're going to. So I've invited Ben Gold, who was a big celebrity around these parts once upon a time, back in the day. Stargate, Hubert, He won the That's Incredible competition, as you guys saw it there. And even got, he won that millipede machine, right? Bobby Sherman was shaking your hand for. And then, of course, got right next to me here, got Thor Aackerlund, the man who won the 1990 Nintendo World Championships. And actually got one of those cartridges that everybody salivates over about today. So you don't have it anymore, though, do you?
It's tucked away in my, the cartridge is you have to be a spelunker to get it. It's in my dad's garage somewhere.
So if y'all find his address and you have a good strong back, no. There it is. So, you know, like I said, I think both these gentlemen here, they have been at the peak of the mountain. My resume is a bit mixed. I've done a lot of things. These guys hit the top of the hill several times under some high-pressure situations. I'd like to start here with Ben. What, Ben, do you see about the current competitive, the state of current competitive gaming that you think they could take, they could learn from your experiences back in, let's say, 82, 83.
You know, it's. I think there's a couple of thoughts here, and I'm just going to talk without a microphone. When I look at the differences, I mean, back in the day, in 1981, 82, before I had found Twin Galaxies, there was no Facebook, there was no social media, there was no internet. So it was all extremely, people were siloed in their local areas. And it was all hearsay about hearing, you know, about someone else. Very rarely were there any competitions. Maybe they'd be statewide. I think I went to one centipede competition in 1981. But really before 1983, that was very difficult to find out that information. So definitely there's a difference that today when people want to play the classic games, there's a resurgence since the movie King of Kong of the classic gaming. People are looking. You know, they want to be the best Frogger player, or the best Robotron, or the best Donkey Kong player, but, you know, like I said, they can look at, it's different because back then, we put a quarter in, we didn't know if this was a crappy game or if it was a good game. Today, there's YouTube videos, instruction manuals, everyone knows the keys. Now, I think what you're alluding to is the fact that when I was going up the mountain, okay, and going from local competitions into national competitions, and then making it, you know, I mean, when I won That's Incredible, that was like, wow, a national competition amongst some very top game players. We really thought that, I thought that I was going to be a professional game player. You know, like I was going to have the rock star thing, you know, be going to tournaments, you know, every week and have like, you know, real prizes, make, you know, $10,000 or at the time that seemed like a lot of money, you know, or be able to have a career out of that. And I really thought in 1982, 83 that's what I was going to do. And then, you know, I got a pretty rude awakening in 1983 around the summertime when all of the arcades I went to basically started closing down at the same time. And the entire scene crashed intensively. And I think that again, that these different genres, that there's it's got to be careful that what drives it, the economics behind it, is sustainable. And that's a whole other conversation about the arcade scene and why it crashed. Because it was not sustainable with the quarters going in, and they didn't really build a culture. I don't know, but when I quit, I kind of quit for 20 years. So like, I did not know who you were, Thor, until a couple of years ago. Because I honestly, you know, I just went, when you were resurging, I went out of the gaming industry. So that's kind of, does that answer your question, Scott, or is that?
I'll come back with other ones. I've got a little segue into Thor here, because. You know, I know somebody. I heard somebody bring up the wizard when they were watching Thor play. I hear that comparison a lot. One thing I didn't make it near as far as this man here in the 1990 Nintendo World Championships. But that event was such an interesting. It's so interesting to compare it to what you're starting to see now, where a lot of people talk about these big MLG competitions and stuff, and. You know, I can't help but think back to that down at the auto building at Fair Park in 1990. That automotive building, y'all going to the state fair and gone in there. They have all those cars that none of us will ever possibly afford. But you get to crawl in them for a little while and you're afraid to touch anything. That building right there was filled. It was Nintendo, wall to wall. And there's the big stage and the big screen and the insanely energetic announcer. And I know for my seed, I kind of felt with that, even though I choked in the semifinals. Freaking Channel 4 camera made a 14-year-old kid way too nervous is what happened. And I choked badly and I got eliminated. But I thought, just like Ben was describing with the peak of his competitive gaming career, I thought that this was the beginning of all these sort of things. That now there's going to be... Excuse me, son. I thought that there was going to be a... I thought that was going to be it. That was the start of a new generation, and there's going to be one of those every year forever, and they're going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. It's really the only one they ever did like that. You know, they did some smaller ones, and they started calling them Power Fest, you know, which I didn't think that was as cool of a name as Nintendo World Championships. I thought that was a lot cooler of a name, but I see a lot of similarities in that event to the MLG-style stuff that's going on now. This man here, however, this guy came out on top of it all. How many people total did you basically beat out to win that again?
The last number I heard was 1.1
million. 1.1
million
people. So as big as MLG events, as big as the MLG events and that sort of thing are going, I don't quite think they've reached the million mark yet, not participant-wise. What would you, Thor, draw comparisons between the 1990 Nintendo World Championships and what is rising and growing now with stuff like MLG and eSports?
Well, I guess the first thing I'd say is that back in the 1990 Nintendo World Championships, you had Mario was recognizable everywhere. And so it started to penetrate mainstream culture. But there was a dichotomy at the time because I think that people that were running the media and even some of the people that were running the gaming corporations didn't understand it quite as well as the fans did. For example, there was a television deal to broadcast the Nintendo World Championships, and that collapsed probably due to misunderstanding on how to deal with that. But now the guys in the media corporations they're us. I mean, the people that grew up with gaming. So I think that it can continue to build with a lot easier transitions. And plus, we run the media. I mean, social media, all you guys right here, you know, commenting and sharing what you love are connected. So it's really easy for even a game that's an independent game to get a huge fan base together. I mean, you have a couple hundred thousand people that, you know, really are passionate about one thing, and you can find information about that online and share it.
Now, after you won that, you know, a couple years, like you guys saw, you got to be on the Home Shopping Network with that awesome announcer as well. Look at that. That's actually a relic.
This is a sealed Quattro Adventure for NES.
Wow.
It's four OK games on one cartridge.
How many here have that one? Oh damn! Okay. I thought I was gonna get the room with that. What did you see at the time? Because I mean, you going a lot further. You were a lot closer to you know, the inner circle and the conversations that were going on around that championship. Why do you think after that big grandiose start that they didn't even try it on that same level again after that?
Well. I'm not sure how much y'all know about the Nintendo World Championships, but it was really, really expensive to produce. There were, I think, something like 20 or 30 full semi-tractor trailers, and they filled up the biggest convention centers in each city. And they had sponsors, but you have to think that it was very expensive to produce. And I think that they were banking on the television deal. And right up until, I think, a week or two before the finals, it was so-called done deal, and then all of a sudden it didn't happen. And I think that probably put a big question mark in the people that wrote the checks for that kind of thing. So that when they transitioned to the Campus Challenge and Power Fest, instead of the 30-city gigantic tour, it was like in college campuses here and there, in malls. You know.
I had to do one in a venture department store parking lot. That was exciting.
Yeah. So I think
how many rounds was the competition?
What's that?
How many rounds was it from beginning to end?
The tournament structure was that you could show up Friday or Saturday at one of these events, and if you scored more than a set points, I think it was 200,000 points on the cartridge, you got a little gold star, and you could come back for the semifinals. And they took, I think, the top seven out of that. And then they moved to the two, and then the one. And that was for each city for three age groups. And then the overall winner for each age group from each city got flown to California for the finals.
Now, hold on, we're going to get to a couple here in a moment. Because the one thing I find common between, you know, both our public event champions back in the day is that, you know, it didn't go on for years and years after. I mean, for a little while, both of them, both Ben and Thor were, you know, if you want to use the term video game celebrity or personality or whatever, you know, they popped up in quite a few things. I mean, Ben popped up in a few shows, and even in this Life magazine photo, you know,
yeah,
the show.
I was going to say that this is one of the thing that, well, I was, as a matter of fact, I just met in the audience a friend of mine, Doug, that I haven't seen in 30 years. I used to play in the local Dallas scene, and it was November of 1982, after having set a world record on Stargate, that I got invited by Walter Day. I discovered Twin Galaxies and got the opportunity to meet nationally all the top players. And so this is where I met Billy Mitchell, Steve Sanders, and a lot of the people that you see in the movie Chasing Ghosts and King of Kong. And by the way, Billy isn't that bad of a guy. What happens is that was kind of from there. It was like a 6 month period where I was famous. And it's kind of good to be famous for really 15 minutes, because, you know, for those moments, people knew who I was. But then it wasn't wildly famous that I couldn't walk outside, you know, like a Michael Jackson or someone like that, that you have to have, you know, people around you to protect against.
I don't think you can pull up that look anyway.
Yeah, I don't think so. But it's. But I'm just saying that it was a great experience, and so that was. Except for me, when I understood that it wasn't after 6 months and trying everything to make a competitive culture, trying to make a professional culture, and as everything crashed around me, and the last straw was the summer driving around with Walter Day and Billy Mitchell and Steve Harris in a car. Or in a bus that broke down, then in a car, we drove around the country as the U.S. national video game team, and I felt more like the 1860 baseball players, you know, the ones going traveling around in the bus, trying to make something happen, and that was kind of my last straw.
Well, and that's what it was. I mean, it was both of y'all had kind of the fame for a little while, and then it kind of wasn't there, and I see a lot and talk to a lot of competitive players now, a lot of which maybe aren't even aware of, like what Ben was showing there. That was actually the first time that champion gamers from all around the country had gone to one competition in the same place. I mean, that was a very historic photo. But I see a lot of, I talk to a lot now, and they're convinced. A lot of them, they're like, this keeps getting bigger and bigger, and MLG is going to get TV. Like the Nintendo World Championships were, and they may or may not. It's a whole other topic to go there. But a lot of them, I fear that they might be setting themselves up for a little bit of a fall. I mean, obviously, I want to see the whole thing continue to grow and explode as it seems primed to do. But in any given moment, something could go wrong. Just like with the Nintendo World Championships. If a deal falls through, the people signing the checks aren't going to be as willing to keep sinking money into something if they're not able to get that big golden paycheck. And it's not like the NFL or the NBA or MMA or whatever. There's numerous other places you can go or numerous other things that's already set up. This is still something that's growing and young. So I'll start with you, Ben. To an esports player today, who is like, man, I'm the best at Call of Duty, and this is never going to end, and I've won some money, and I'm about to be a big guy, big celebrity man. What advice would you have for that guy if and when that doesn't end up working out for him?
Well, the way I can put it is that, okay, in 2010, I was invited to be a member of the Video Game Hall of Fame that was based in Ottumwa, Iowa, and I was there with Steve Sanders, and we were with Fatality. Do you guys know Fatality? Okay, he's a nice guy. Okay, and we're having some drinks, and Steve Sanders said something extremely profound. He put his arm, and of course he doesn't call him Fatality, he says Jonathan. So he's like, Jonathan, you are living the lifestyle we thought we were going to live. Okay? Because Fatality is
a brand.
You know, what?
A brand. He's managed
he's
to
a brand. He is somebody who was able to become a full-time professional video game player. Okay? Now, for every Fatality, there's at least 20 to 30,000 Fatality wannabes. And there's going to be, you know, and it's just like if you think of it from the point of view of professional sports, for every Roger Staubach, there might be, you know, 30 or 40 people that had a good chance to become the quarterback for a professional team. Maybe they made it or got put on in reserve, and maybe were part of professional sports. Then there's a whole slew of people that I think they all have to do the same amount of work. And it's just important to understand that it's important to understand this. It's good to have a plan B. Okay? I lived video games between the age of 13 and 17. Okay, that's when I was like obsessed. My brain couldn't think about anything else. So I was still a student, but I still studied. Okay, I still got good grades. I still did sports. And then what time was left over, I played video games. Okay? And so that's my thought. It's just the perspective, because it will end. Even if you are the best player of Call of Duty for 1 year, or for if you can do it for a year, for one competition, the next competition, everybody's going to be after you. Okay, I mean, that's what makes Fatality so powerful, is that he was able to win time after time. But it's very difficult, because I am, as a competitor, I succeeded because I had a very low profile. I learned, just don't say stupid crap, because then you get people looking at you and say, I've got you marked. No, I just stay silent. And then when you win, people look back and say, what just happened? Okay, I'll bet you that for the Nintendo, you probably didn't, you don't look like the kind of guy that talks smack.
Oh, no.
Well, just kicked everyone's butt, okay? Yes?
My question, would you say what's different between nowadays of competitive gaming compared to the past is in the past it was more against you against the computer, and now it's people against people, the reason why the culture around it has changed?
Well, I think that and the internet. Okay, I think the internet is what has changed it, is the online community, because two things. We couldn't monetize. So owners got really mad at arcades when I spent 36 hours on a quarter. It meant I'm tying a $2,000 investment for 2 days. Okay, and they didn't see the value of creating the competitive culture, because we were their enemy. They loved us for the first $100 we plunked into the machine. They hated us for the next $3 that we'd spent a month on their machine. So the thing is that the internet made the online gaming, changed the whole monetization, the idea you pay 15 bucks a month. And so that's number one. Number two, like my son, who's in the audience right here, he plays more than I ever did. Because when I went to the arcade, I had to come home at 9 o'clock. Okay? Now there are kids or people that can play all night long. Okay? That we can't do that back then. What were you gonna say? Sorry.
Well, let me send that over to the same question over to you, Thor, because I mean it was the Nintendo era was of course a different era than the early 80s arcades. The arcades had crashed out in the mid 80s and they kind of leveled up a little bit in the 90s, but there was no doubt that it was the Nintendo that completely dominated the industry. I think they had at 1.93% market share, which is just unheard of in any console era. I don't think we'll ever see anything like that again. So, 1990, high profile, you won the Nintendo World Championship, so you were the king of the biggest brand in video game history at that point, and arguably even still today. How long did that 15 minutes of fame actually last?
Well, it's kind of funny that you say that. After the competition, somebody else, my good friend Robin Mahara, remarked that the first thing that I said was, I'm glad it's over. Because it was pretty stressful for a 13-year-old going through the competition. After that, my family had a really rough time for a bunch of stuff I'm not going to go into. But it was actually really lucky that I won that competition, because it was able to keep us in a house for another 3 years. Just getting all the endorsements and selling games. And you know, the first game that these guys had to show me was Micro Machines, which was pretty good. And then after that, they were, some of them were okay, but some of them were quite bad. So if y'all bought a game that you didn't like, I'm sorry. But, you know, the experience was fun. You know, there wasn't really much negative about it. I did feel that I told everybody around me, and especially my dad, this is not going to last that long. Because I looked at the Power Fest and I was like, it's dissipating. They're just not putting the energy into it. It's not that it wouldn't have been successful if they tried. You know, if you had the right people in the media together with the right people in the industry, make that investment. Because people had a blast at these things. I mean, going to play all the games and hanging out with other Nintendo fans, it was amazing. But they just didn't follow it up right. And I could just see it floating down. And so I had fun, but I just say that's my biggest tip for anybody in professional gaming, is that at the end of the day, if you're not having fun, there's no point. You know, whether you win or lose, I mean, if you're playing a game you hate or it's not helping you out, then there's no point.
And, you know, my resume takes a little bit of a different turn from these guys. I've been gaming for, I think, 32 years this fall. And I've never stuck with just one era. I keep going through, and I'll even keep playing the stuff that's coming out this fall and the new consoles. I never won a major thing like That's Incredible, the 1990 Nintendo World Championships, but I went pretty deep in some. I won some regional stuff around the area here, some stuff over in Mesquite in the 90s, when there was actually a whole bunch of arcades out there. You know, I never had the big prize money and the news coverage and the Life magazine, but I did okay for myself. And one thing I do find about it is there's a lot of people that are wanting to make their way, just like they did in the 80s with the whole Twin Galaxies, you know, revolution, just like they did in the 90s with the Nintendo stuff blowing up and even Sega's championships, and even today. I'm actually finding it easier for me to make money-making opportunities for myself as a video game personality without competing in anything anymore. And so while I admire those that are like, eSports are going up, so I need to be the absolute best at this game and this game and this game and make myself this star, just like you mentioned Fatality, he's made more money, I think, hawking merchandise over the last few years than he did winning competitions. He doesn't even have to pick up a controller anymore.
Yeah.
And I do think that as many people as they're wanting to compete in the whole eSports thing, I do think that it's worth considering another avenue of taking it. Because eventually even the game you're good at, a good friend of mine out in California, C.G. Thornton, she gained her fame by being a Guitar Hero champion. That's not exactly going to pay her bills now. It's, you know, Guitar Hero is now in the back shelf at GameStop, and those plastic guitars are filling every thrift store in the country. She's managed to find a way to take what she got there, and she it pops up in reality shows. She was in Robot Combat League on the Sci-Fi Channel a few months back. Now she's doing something with Ford, and she actually is getting to drive a car all around the country and get paid for it, like, all summer long. So, I mean, I think that's worth note. You know, I think that as many people as are trying to get into the whole eSport thing and make money, that's always been that way, which is kind of what the chat is here about. It was that way in the 80s, and it was at the high, and then there's a very quick low. It was like that in the 90s, and it's like that. It can be like that today. I think that there's almost a greater need or greater opportunity at the moment for content, entertaining content at that, not being the guy with the webcam and the WordPress page that wants to yell at Xbox One all day. There's a million of those right now. But I think there's at least as many opportunities, if not more, for that sort of thing than just putting all your eggs in one basket and say, I'm gonna be an MLG superstar and make all kinds of money, because that's going to be the level of the NFL. And how long, you know, it took the NFL, I think, 40, 50 years to really reach what it is now. Same with NASCAR, same with the NBA, and probably going to be the same with the eSports. Because this isn't the first time everything looked on the up and up. There's been, you know, two living examples of it right here with me. With that, we've got, you know, kind of three different generations of the road here. It's y'all's time. The floor is, I'm sure we'll get some questions. He's He's very eager. So go ahead, Ben.
You think with the expansion of Major League Gaming, that other video game related aspects could enter pop culture? Like,
well, I think it already is. It's actually the whole catchphrase to my brand and what I put on my website is I say video gaming is pop culture, because you're seeing it now to where that doesn't mean pop culture is starting to realize that, hey, a lot of people play video games and they're not a bunch of introverts in mom's basement. They actually have girlfriends and boyfriends and husbands and kids and jobs. Hey, wow, this is normal. It's because those earliest generations of gamers that grew up in a world that never didn't know video games. I mean, I know when me and Ben, probably even with Thor, when we all first started playing, video games were the hot new fad, the hot new thing. Actually, we went through that twice. We went through that in the early 80s, and then we went through that again when the Nintendo came out. And now it's something that's always been around. I mean, I don't know if there's anyone in the room that remembers was, you know, I can tell from looking at it. There's no one here that remembers an era where there wasn't a television in your home. There's people here that, you know, some people here probably don't ever remember a world where there wasn't a cell phone. You know, where I remember, you know, I used to be, if my car broke down, I had to hook it about 5 miles, find a pay phone, hope I had a quarter. And there's generations that don't know a world that never had video games. And those generations are now grown up, and they're not just the ones making the video games, they're the ones making movies. They're the ones making television. They're the ones making music. There are pro athletes. There are actors and our actresses, or even our news anchors, and probably in someday, hopefully, they're going to be our politicians. And, you know, we quit getting these nonsensical laws trying to be passed to regulate video games by people that, you know, 50 years older than the video game industry is. That's probably going to be covered in my panel tomorrow, though. But you know, I think MLG, so far, and I think that's one of the barriers, is I don't think that it is properly, it's huge in gaming, but I don't think it's properly punched through to that pop culture. Whereas we all know what it is. We're all these diehards, but your average Joe six-pack that comes home from his blue-collar job at the end of the day, wants to just blow crap up on Call of Duty, not caring about his KD ratio and what clan he's in, probably isn't really in tune with that. The mainstream so far, pop culture so far, doesn't know who those top teams and those top clans are. So I think it's, instead of pop culture, kind of, you know, I think they have to punch into pop culture for them to continue to grow beyond what they are right now.
I wanted just to add a couple of things to that. So, two things. Today, I mean, what's ironic, when I was a kid, you know, I played games and stuff, and it was the new thing. Today, one of the activities that still drives me, I'm very big on promoting the history, culture of gaming, so I have a booth out there, the International Video Game Auction House, where I deal in high-end video game memorabilia. And so it's interesting that the stuff that I had as a kid is now, you know, some of it's very rare and sought after. And so there is this feeling, it's the beginning of it, of this appreciation that video game does have a lineage, does have a history. You have Nolan Bushnell. You know, you have Ralph Baer, you have Walter Day. So there are these people that are being recognized as having, had an impact over the years. Now, the thing that Scott was talking about, when I was 15 and 16 and I was playing, all my friends' parents said, if I told you the things they said, that I was going to be a drug addict, that I was, bad influence on their kid, that video games are evil, that all these terrible things, and I was like, and then okay, but then when I went on That's Incredible, then all of a sudden, like, well, I guess there's some skill involved, I guess it's, you know, and I was like, and so for me, I said, you know, the thing is this, it's just like anything else, okay, and my take on this is I today video games permeate our kids. I mean, I have a 5-year-old that, because of my 11-year-old, is now playing Minecraft, and I don't like that. Okay, and it's actually, my 11-year-old can handle it. He understands it, he's got a very mature level. My 5-year-old cannot handle it, and that's causing some issues. And so this is it's a parenting thing. I don't blame the game, but I do think that, you know, it's important for parents to monitor, because I don't think, you know, 5-year-old kids should be blowing other kids up or blowing other images up, or there should be some monitoring, but again, it's just like TV, you know? I mean, if you leave a kid in front of a TV and they flip around, or if you leave them in front of YouTube, Okay, like I left my daughter in front of YouTube and she was watching Dora, and then about 5 minutes later she was watching a Spanish version of Dora where it was a parody where she was like a prostitute and, you know, Matt was like a pimp, and I'm sitting here going, no, this is not, I don't think you really need to be watching this. So anyways, I'm just saying.
That's an unexpected term.
What? But that's what happened. Trust me, you go onto YouTube and you pick any subject and just click about five different times, you'd be shocked where you end up.
Okay. Yeah, I know.
Anyway. So any other questions out there, guys? I saw, go ahead.
Do you guys fear of maybe an oversaturation that's happening now with all the sorts of mediums we have for video games? I mean, whether it be the different consoles, the computer, the phone, if that's creating kind of an overwash for some of the new gamers coming into it, which may have happened back in the arcade days, where you're getting all these arcades that are not really, I mean, these arcade games that are not really games, they're just quarter grabs. They're just trying to take in all the money. I mean, I see a lot of it in cell phone games where they just want to get people to give them money, and as much as I hate to say it, for some of the console games, you're getting games that they're releasing partial games and then selling you more of the game down the road. Do you see that as kind of like hindering?
It depends on who it is. I think that at the moment, at least you have a lot of manufacturers, some of which they're trying to do that, and you got enough other ones that are standing up and saying, well, we're not going to do it that way. And so that's slowing that coming along, because that just means they're going to grab the people that don't like that. But it is interesting what you said, because it was oversaturation that actually caused the was a big part of what caused that arcade crash in the early 80s. It wasn't so much, you know, bad games. I mean, that was part of it. There were some really bad games that started coming out in 83 and 84 that they just wanted to just roll out something to sell to the operators for $3,000 and get you to stick your money in. But there was a bigger problem was that a lot of older games came out and they sold them. They were in every street corner, especially like a Pac-Man and Donkey Kongs and Defenders. And so eventually the gamers grew tired of those games. Those operators still had the, you know, we're talking some of them, half their route was Pac-Man. So when people start getting tired of the game, or those that weren't tired of it were able to play it for 5-6 hours at a clip, wasn't making any money, they still had those. It wasn't like a pool table or a Coke machine or whatever. They can keep putting it out for years and years to come. It was just a big piece of expensive equipment they couldn't do anything with. And I do see a little bit of a risk of that with what we're going into at the moment, because this last console generation just sold so much product. I mean, all three current consoles, the 360, the PS3, and the Wii, are three of the top five best-selling consoles of all time. Three of the top five from the same generation. Something like that's never happened before. And so I do think while the public is eager for these new consoles, clearly they are, it's all anyone's been talking about for the last few weeks especially, I think that there's a little bit of an issue. I think, in fact, I think it's one of the reasons the Wii U is struggling a little bit, because you had a lot of that casual base by the Wii that maybe otherwise wouldn't have bought a game console. That's great. They sold 100 million Nintendo Wiis. They don't understand why they got to buy something new now. They don't understand why they have to do that. Well, I still have this older one. And then they're going to start getting unhappy as they cancel the functionality of it and less product comes out for it. Eventually, especially my mother-in-law is going to flip when the Netflix thing goes down. You know it's going to happen at some point. And so I do think that puts the industry in an interesting situation right now. But I just came back from E3, and I do got to say that the product, and I'm not talking about the money grabs like Killer Instinct, you know, where you're going to get one character and you have to buy every other character that comes out. It's a free game. But a lot of the games I've sampled there this year, a lot of stuff that the companies are coming up with that aren't money grabs, that are just trying to make damn good games, some of the best crop of games I've seen at an E3 in half a decade. So I think I'm hopeful that that's going to overshadow the attempts at the money grabs and the oversaturation, and maybe make people go ahead and continue forward and without, you know, really. I do think GameStop's going to get flooded with a lot of consoles, but you know, they've jerked us around enough times. So. y'all got something?
Okay. Oh. Some more questions?
I've read the news that the disappointing Wii U sales, that there's some talk that Nintendo might get liquidated or leave the industry, and it would be the end of an era if they did. Do you think that's ever going to happen?
No. Here's the thing. They run a very smart business. You know, there's businesses out there in the world today that make billions of dollars and yet take a loss. There's companies out there that make $20,000 in a year and make a profit. It's all how they do their books. Nintendo has cash on hand. They don't really have a lot of debt. They're in a situation where they have a comfort zone where they can wait a little while. The 3DS started bad too. 3DS was tanking in sales when it first came out. Now it's rocking it out. Now they're selling a lot of them. I think the Wii U actually stands to be the biggest benefit this holiday season if Microsoft and Sony fail to get enough product on the shelves. I think people will buy the Wii U as an alternative. It's going to be the cheapest one, and they're going to have a lot of them on the shelves. They do now. They might be dusty, but they'll be out there. I don't see them leaving the console market in the foreseeable future. So in the back.
I grew up when Nintendo just came out. What are your thoughts on DLC? Because when DLC in my age was called an expansion, you had a full-fledged game. Now you have companies that are just, you know, here's a DLC character, here's a DLC mission, here's a DLC, you know, side quest here and there, or maybe four quests. What are your thoughts on that in the gaming industry and the impact that it's going to have going forward? Because everyone's going to start doing that. Say otherwise.
I think it depends on how they do it. You know, when a game comes out and day one there's DLC, it pisses me off. As I'm sure everybody here agree with that. I mean, I just paid $60 for this game. Why can't I use everything that's on it already? I mean, I didn't buy a car and these aren't additional options. I think when it's something, you know, like Call of Duty does. I mean, everyone, you play that multiplayer long enough, you get sick of the maps it comes with. It's kind of good to have additional maps later. I don't have to buy them. I can still play without them. I can choose to buy them. I think that's okay to kind of keep a game fresh, especially if it's something you're going to play a lot of. When it's just like I said, Killer Instinct, it's going to come free on the Xbox One, but you get one character. And you have to buy all the other ones you want. I think it's a bunch of trash. I think that's, I don't like it. But I think we just learned something with the Xbox One. I think if enough consumers come out and say, we don't like this, I think the game companies are listening. I think we just learned that with the Xbox One. I think Thor has a lot to say on those types of things.
Oh yeah, I was one of the most vocal people about the Xbox One, like potentially alienating their fan base with their initial decisions. They've really turned that around. It's impressive. As for DLC, I do think that it does run a risk of burning a lot of people. And one of the greatest examples is basically any of your cell phone games or Facebook games. And like they let you play for like 5 minutes, and then it's like, oh, you need these credits to do this and that. And it adds to the fracturing of our experience as gamers. It's good to have a wide variety of things to choose from, but we've got it coming out of our ears now. Like, you can have 10 different gamers in a room that all play games religiously, but the chances of them all playing the same games are almost astronomical. So they'll have interesting things to talk about and share, but it leaves maybe a smaller chance for people to get together just randomly and know the same game. Whereas back in the day, Mario, it was like everybody played that. So it's an interesting question. I do think that companies need to dial it down just a little bit. I think if companies like Nintendo and Microsoft and Sony set an example with their first party titles and first class stuff, that they're not going to nickel and dime people and push people around, that's where the customers are going to go. They're going to go where they're treated the best.
I was going to say that one of the really interesting things back in the day, in the arcade era, is that the manufacturers didn't know who their clients were. So the manufacturers thought their client was the arcade owners. And so when I would go to the industry events, the AMOA I mean, I had a subscription to Replay and Play Meter magazine. I read all that stuff when I was playing, and I wanted to know what was happening in the industry. And it was very frustrating because there'd be articles in the industry saying, and actually one of them mentions, you know, why should we celebrate when Ben Gold spends 36 hours tying up my $2,000 investment? Okay, why are we promoting this? This is against our interest. I mean, an actual article. And so there's a guy, you might have heard of him, Steve Harris. Who's heard of Steve Harris? Okay, he is the person who created Electronic Gaming Monthly, but he keeps a low, you know, profile from the point of view of, you know, he doesn't really like to get up in front, but he's probably the most successful financially from our generation. Yeah. And we used to travel the country, and one of the things he did was he actually would go, we would go to these events, and he had created this thing of, I know it's a crazy concept, of giving feedback to the manufacturers. So we would go to these, we would take the games, okay, we would actually play them there, we'd rate them, and we'd come back to them and say, here's our rating. And they looked at us like we were from a different planet. Like, why the hell do you need, why would we want you to rate our games? I mean, that was their attitude in 1983. And of course, the result of that is that when we stopped going to the arcade owners couldn't pay their rent, and they went out of business, and then they ordered less consoles, and then that caused financial pain to the manufacturers. And so there was a huge disconnect. I don't know if that's happening today.
Yeah.
But when there's that disconnect between the people that make the games and the people that play the games, then somebody's going bankrupt.
That's still happening, unfortunately, today. Not with every company. And with the internet, of course, now every player gives feedback. Whether it be social media, or blogs, or, you know, video, you know, YouTube videos, whatever. But there are some manufacturers that they try to listen, and there's some that try to dictate what the players are going to want. And so that's one lesson, unfortunately, I still don't think has been learned across the board.
Interesting. Okay.
You, sir.
So I was wondering what all three of you thought on what game or what type of game has the potential to become kind of like what StarCraft is in South Korea for the United States, where it would basically be like a competitive sport that people watch every year.
If it wasn't a little saturated at the moment, I would think, because I mean they've had big money championships already, I think Call of Duty isn't really pushing itself out as much as it can. That's about as mainstream of a hit as you get in this country. I mean, they sell 25 million copies a year, and it sure as heck not all the people that go to Kotaku and IGN, because they hate it. But, you know, I know a lot of people that's, you know, about all they play is that and Madden. And, you know, and that seems to be the norm, and I think that's the audience that they need to try and get. I don't think that competitive gaming is taken near seriously in this country right now, kind of due to the fact that no one has kind of stood up and said, we're going to be that. You know, your mainstream person, if they've heard of MLG or any of the other leagues, you know, they might not even know what games they're playing. And so, and then some of that's just trial and error. I mean, we're about to hit a brand new console era here with a lot of new technology. And I think one of the most interesting things that people aren't talking about, in lieu of the whole digital rights management controversy and all that stuff, is the fact both the PS4 and the Xbox One are going to allow people to stream directly from their consoles. Twitch is doing Xbox One, Ustream is doing the thing with PS4. I think there's a lot of people that aren't streaming already because you have to get all the extra stuff and all the extra setup that are going to start. And I think because of those features on those consoles, there's a chance that your question might be answered just by the law of averages. As people start to stream what they're playing, something might catch on because it's going to be a lot more content coming on there.
I was just going to say that if you take like the only thing game that I can think of in the classic era, because there's probably, I would say, you know, 0.001% of the gamers are the hardcore arcade gamers. I mean, there is a culture of that, and that would be Donkey Kong. Because of the King of Kong movie, you know, there's still today a lot of players. Once a year now, we have a Kong Off event that is the top players play against each other. So that's about the closest thing I could see in the classic gaming industry of having some sort of standard. But I don't know. I mean, is there something in the? Do you know? Are you like you're a champion of Tetris, right? Did you ever have a world record in Tetris? Is there a way to measure the game, like a high score per se?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Do you hold that record today?
Well, there's so many different versions of Tetris. Classic NES Tetris, yes.
Nobody's ever beaten that for me?
Other people that have maxed it out. I think we're up to maybe half a dozen now.
Okay, so it's kind of like you can max. So it's kind of like the perfect Pac-Man. You could have a max for that. Is there a goal or whatever for people in your genre to do that?
Yeah, and there's always new challenges. There's somebody's going to try to probably. I bet they will eventually get level 31. Somebody's going to do that.
Well, I think one thing though too. I think this with the whole esports thing. I think one of the challenges to it growing a little bit. And I'm never sure what the exact answer to this is going to be. Is, you know, I hear a lot of people, they want to compare it to the NBA or the NFL, this or that. Well, here's the thing. The NFL, it's still football. It's never going to drastically change. I mean, it has over time. They didn't even used to have passing in the NFL, you know. Hockey is always going to be hockey. NASCAR is always going to be NASCAR. There's going to be slight tweaks, but the same core of that sport's always going to be the same. And with video games, it's not really, it's never been that way. I mean, the differences in the games that Ben played competitively were a lot different from what Thor played competitively. You know, and it's just, it's such a tremendous thing where, you know, Pac-Man used to rule the world. You know, and Super Mario Brothers, the side-scrolling games ruled the world, and the fighting games ruled the world, and they still have a little bit of an interest now. Now it's first-person shooters and stuff like League of Legends, you know, but video games are always going to jump around. They're always going to be different from one another. I think that sometimes might hinder its growth from a competitive and spectator type of thing because it's kind of hard to build up. You're not going to, you know, Pac-Man still has resonance today, so does Tetris, but you're not going to put it on television. You know, it's not going to build up for decades and decades like football or baseball did before it becomes a big thing. But I think that's one of the things that kind of hurts it a little bit. Video games are always changing, they're always morphing, and things with like the VR technology that now they're showing as well. I mean, I think it's about to start changing again. You, sir.
You mentioned streaming. Now that all these next-gen consoles have streaming capabilities, do you think the infrastructure is there to handle online gaming live streaming? I stream right now, and it really relies on your upstream depending to determine the quality of your output.
If it's not there, I think it's going to get there. I mean, I remember people always keep talking about Xbox controversies right now. I remember an Xbox controversy in 2001, 2002, when people were mad it didn't have a dial-up modem. It was broadband only, and people were like, oh my God, not everybody has broadband right now. This is ridiculous, this won't work. It sounds really silly now, because, I mean, we didn't have anyone that had dial-up in 2001, 2002, probably didn't have it in 2004, 2005. They certainly, hopefully, don't have it now. Does anyone have dial-up? There you go. I think that if there's a problem with that now, I mean, I think that it's hopefully only a temporary one anyway.
The biggest thing is, originally we have file servers, so your upstream was adequate for online gaming and streaming with good quality for these games like Call of Duty, Street Fighter, what have you, that have high action 3D graphics. Well, down here, Universe, Time Warner, the max you're going to get is 5 megs up, and that's really pushing
bank at that point. Well, and there's other places. I got a good friend that lives in Iowa. That, you know, he's about as tried true as a gamer as there is. He played for 30 something years and what have you. Actually, Ben used to play with him.
Who?
Tim McVeigh.
Yeah, Tim McVeigh.
He doesn't have. Yeah, he knows he doesn't. He can't even use Netflix without buffering on his 360, and so he's kind of like, yeah, well, you know, he doesn't know how long the technology will take. So, I mean, I do think there are going to be some growing pains on that with the outlying areas. But when you think about major metropolitan areas, New York City, LA, that sort of stuff, if you add, you know, a few thousand new streamers that are streaming just because with the click of a button they can do it on a new console, I think that'll more than kind of make the difference up. And I still think that, you know, those major areas, population areas, are going to be where you kind of see the first growth, hopefully. We're in a long time.
Yeah, I was going to say there's one, five more minutes.
Yeah, we got one more question, and we're rolling on out here if anyone's got anything. Bueller? The spawn of Ben Gold is raising his hand.
Go right ahead.
What do you think the best video game is, each of your opinions?
Ooh. Wow.
Thor, you go first.
If there's a game that I could just sit down and have fun with, maybe a tie between Mario 3 and Mario World, I can always just have fun with that.
You go next, because I'm still thinking.
Well, I'm thinking, as far as me personally, the only classic game I still play like reasonably well is Millipede. Some people walk up to me and they say, Ben, let's go play. I bet you I can kick your butt. Or there's some people with some big egos. I go, yeah, I'm sure you can kick my butt. I'm retired. You know, I have the Roger Staubach attitude. You know, Roger Staubach had a great career. He threw a lot of touchdowns, won a couple Super Bowls, but then he retired. Nobody's going to ask him to go back on the field and throw touchdown passes. Okay, there's some players that they continually want to play competitively, and as long as you play competitively, then it's, you're a lot more vulnerable. And so the fact that I retired from competitive gaming is an advantage, because nobody really can play the 16-year-old Ben Gold. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you have to go back in time. If you had a flux capacitor, then we could do that. So that's my answer, is Millipede, but I do play a lot of those little board games, jewel games or whatever, on my iPhone. But that, I don't know if that counts. So.
I think to me it just depends on what mood I'm in. I mean, if I want to relax and not worry about achievement points or high score or whatever, I can pop up something like a Tetris or a Minecraft. But you know, one of the ones you mentioned right there, you know, I don't think any single game that I played before it or even since, if I want to kick back and just feel like a kid and just pure joy of just playing a video game and get a long time play experience out of it, I don't know, Super Mario Bros. 3 could be topped in that. You know, depending on, you know, I want to sit around and lose a couple hours and just, you know, remember what's good about video gaming. That one probably always stand that test of time.
Good question.
Yes. All right, Mr. Gold here, because we gotta run and stuff. There's lots of other exciting things, but where can they find you in this show?
I'm in the dealer booth. So I'm kind of, as you get in, go in the back area. It's the International Video Game Auction House. I would love to talk to you when we're here. We're till 6. I'll be here also Saturday and Sunday.
Mr. Thor.
I'll be milling about. I'll probably hang out with him for a bit.
All right. I do thank everyone for coming out. And I got another panel tomorrow, which is kind of given the video gaming side of the violent video game debate. You know, the media never talks to us for some reason. They always talk to child psychology experts with bad haircuts and stuff, politicians. But I'll be doing that tomorrow at 11:30. And joining me on that panel, I'm very excited to say, is Mr. Adam Sessler himself. So we're gonna go up there and take that subject and kick its ass. So give gaming that equal time that, you know, Fox News and Washington doesn't want to give. So I'm hoping some of y'all come out for that. It's gonna prove to be interesting, I'm sure.
Just a final note, be sure to put in your cell phones or tablets or whatever you got, patrickscottpatterson.com. He's got a really cool site that always
like
got new
that.
Content, and it's very exciting to follow. And I just started one called Lost Hammer, so you can find that as well.
I'll do your unexpected plug with one of my own. Ecstasy of Order, the Tetris Masters. It's out there. You can get it on Amazon.com, a bunch of other places. It's a fun documentary film that finally gives Thor some of his much-deserved props from back in the day, as well as adding a new wrinkle to it. Y'all get to know the competitive side of the NES and the NES generation. It's actually a good film. And so he's prominent in it, and you get to see him do something on Tetris that no one else that we know has done so far.
They'll probably try.
Oh, yeah.
So, thank you very much, everybody, and have some fun.